Imagine that you have a set of tasks of different importance, and you want to store them in a way that will always let you quickly access to the most important one. If you just throw them in an array, every time you want to find the most important task, you'd need to traverse the whole array to find it, an operation whose time complexity is of n, kinda slow. But what if you put them in an array sorted by importance this time? It's true that the most important task will always be on the last cell, which costs O(1) to extract. But you'd have two new problems. Building the array would cost you O(n log n) because you have to sort it. And inserting an element would cost you O(n) because you need to respect the order, so you have to insert it in a specific place. And even if you use binary search, you'd still need to maybe shift elements, which causes O(n) time complexity. What's the solution then? Well, we have this data structure that you will learn about today that is called the heap. The heap is a tree data structure where each node is smaller than or equal to its children if it's a min heap, or greater than or equal to its children if it's a max heap, depending on the type. For example, the one on the screen is a min heap. And because the root is smaller than or equal to its children, in case of min heap, and its children are also smaller than or equal to their children, and so on, then the root is smaller than or equal to all the nodes in the heap. Hence, the root is always the smallest element. Same logic for max heap, but with the word greater. We deduce that getting the smallest or greatest element in a min heap or max heap respectively costs O(1), because we know that is the root. It's a great advantage. We have different variants of the heap. We have the binary heap, the Fibonacci heap, the 2-3 heap, and many other ones. Today, we will study the most famous one, the binary heap. The binary heap is a complete binary tree that respects the heap property. A complete binary tree is basically a binary tree where every level is completely filled, except maybe the last one, but all its nodes have to be as far to the left as possible. So we can neither have a null value in a non-last level, nor null value before a node in the last level. To store a binary tree, we usually have a tree class or something like that, but when the binary tree is complete, like for the binary heap, we can just store it in an array, which is more efficient. Why? Because when a binary tree is complete, we have no problem to find the related nodes when we store it in an array. For any node at the index I, we can find its left child, which is at the index 2i+1, its right child, which is at the index 2i+2, and its parent, which is at the index i-1/2. Therefore, we can easily move between the nodes just by calculating the index. And that's what we will do when we implement the binary heap. We will store it in an array, but I will still show you the tree representation to understand what's happening. We have 5 main operations that we need in a binary heap. We want to be able to insert an element, get the min or max element, extract the min or max element, which means getting its value but also removing it from the heap, update the value of a node, and build the heap. You need to know that we cannot add, update, or remove a node from a heap randomly. We need to respect the heap property. For example, if we have this min heap and we insert 5 without doing anything else, we would break the heap property. 10 is not smaller than or equal to its children anymore. To respect the heap property, we need to apply an operation called sift. We have 2 sift operations. We have sift up and sift down. When the node that we want to reposition is at the bottom, we apply sift up, and when it's at the top, we apply sift down. In sift up, we keep swapping the node with its parent while it's smaller. For example, with the 5 here, it's smaller than its parent, so we swap. It's still smaller than its parent, so we swap. It's not smaller anymore, so we stop. The heap property is respected again. In code, we want to sift up the element at index I. So we calculate the index of its parent as shown earlier. Then while it didn't become the root or it's smaller than its parent, we swap the node I with its parent, and I becomes parent index because it took its place in the heap. We also recalculate the parent index for the next iteration. That's it. For sift down, we keep swapping the node while it has a smaller child. If both are smaller, we swap with the smallest one. For example, if we want to sift down 7 in this heap, its right child is smaller, so we swap. Now its left child is smaller, so we swap. Now both are not smaller, so we stop. The heap property is respected again. In code, we want to sift down the element at index I. We start by calculating indexes of left and right children as shown earlier. Then while the node I is greater than one of them, we start by determining the smallest one. The smallest one is the left child if the right one doesn't exist or the left one is smaller than it, else the smallest one is the right child. Now that we found the smallest, we swap between it and the node I. We update the index I because it took the place of the smallest, and we recalculate the indexes of left and right for the next iteration. That's it. And in both of these operations, at each iteration, the node moves by one level in the heap, so the number of iterations depends on the height of the heap. And because the binary heap is a complete tree and a complete tree is always balanced, then the height is an off log n, where n is the number of elements in the heap. So the time complexity of sift up and sift down is off log n. Okay, we know how to sift up and sift down, but why do we need these operations? We need them to insert, update, and delete elements as we will see now. To insert an element in a heap, we just need to insert the value at the end of the array, but it may break the heap property, so we apply sift up on it to take it to the right place. Sift up because it starts at the bottom of the heap. And this operation has an off log n time complexity because we're calling sift up. The second operation is get min, and we know that in a min heap, the smallest element is always at the root, which is the element at index 0 in the array, so we just return a heap of 0, if it exists obviously. We get an O of 1 time complexity for this operation because we already know the index. Next operation is extract min. Here we want to get the minimum value but also to remove it from the heap. First of all, in a tree, we can't just delete the root directly, because its children would have no parent. What we do is that we first swap it with the leaf node and we delete the node that was the root previously. It gets safely deleted because it's a leaf, it has no children. And in a heap, we do the same thing. To delete the root, which is the smallest element, we first swap it with the leaf, we swap it with the last element in the array, and we pop to remove the node. But this operation may break the heap property, so we apply sift down on the new root to take it to the right place, sift down because the root is at the top. In code, we first check that the heap is not empty, then we save the value of the smallest element because we will need to return it later. Now, we swap the root with the last element, and we pop to remove the node. We also sift down the new root, it's at index 0, and we return the min value. The time complexity is also off log n, because we're calling sift down. Next operation, updating the value of a node. We actually have a structure that respects the heap property, but if we update the value, it may break the heap property, so we have to sift. To know if we should sift up or sift down the updated node, we compare the old and the new value. If the new value is smaller, then the node may need to go up, so we sift up. Else if it's greater, then the node may need to go down, so we sift down. Let me show you two examples. Let's update 7 with 2. The new value is smaller, so we sift up. 2 is smaller than its parent, 6, so we swap. It's still smaller than its parent, so we swap. Now we stop because it became the root. Second example, let's replace 12 by 16. The new value is greater, so we sift down. 16 is greater than its left child, so we swap. It has no children anymore, so we stop. The heap property is respected again. In code, it depends on if we have the index of the element that we want to update or not. If we do, we just save the old value to compare later, we update heap of I by assigning the new value, then we compare. If new is smaller than old, we sift up, else we sift down. This operation costs off log n because of sifting. But if we don't have the index, we first need to find the index of the element that we want to update. So if it exists in the heap, we search for its index, then we call the update by index function we made now. This operation costs off n because we first need to search for the element. So, updating an element costs O of log n if we have the index and O of n if we don't. And last operation, building the heap, also called heapify. The optimized way to do so is to traverse indexes of the array that we want to heapify backwards and sift down each element. It's optimized because the cost of sifting down depends on the number of levels between the node and the bottom of the heap. And because we have more nodes that are closer to the bottom, then it's better to use sift down rather than sift up. Sift up would need more operations to process the bottom nodes, because they are far from top. And we traverse backwards to start from the bottom of the heap to avoid sifting down a node and having to do it again later. Let me show you an example. We have this array that represents this binary tree and we want to heapify it. We start from the end of the array. The nodes of the last level have no children, so nothing will happen. Then 7, it has no child, nothing happens. Then 14, both its children are smaller, we swap it with the smallest one. Next node, 15, same thing, we swap it with the smallest child, and it has no children anymore. Next node, same thing, we swap with the smallest one. Next node, 18, 3 and 7 are both smaller, we swap with the smallest one. 18 still has smaller children, we swap with the smallest one. Next node, 11, it has smaller children, we swap with the smallest one. It still has a smaller child, we swap. Last node, it has smaller children, we swap with the smallest one, 3. It still has smaller children, we swap. Now both its children are greater, we stop swapping. And we finished heapifying, the structure now respects the heap property. What about the time complexity? You need to know that when a tree is complete, the last level has at most around n by 2 nodes, where n is the total number of nodes. The level above has around n by 4, then n by 8, and so on until the first level that contains one node, the root. And in sift down, the maximum number of iterations is the number of levels between the level of the actual node and the last level. So nodes of the last level are already in the last level, they can't go down. Let's say that their cost is 0 because we do 0 iterations. Nodes of the level above do at most one iteration, because they are one level far from the last one, let's say that their cost is 1. Then the level above is two levels far from the last one, let's say that the cost is 2. And so on until the root that may require log 2 of n-1 iterations to sift down. And the total cost of heapifying is the sum of each node multiplied by its cost to sift down. We have n by 2 nodes that cost 0, n by 4 nodes that cost 1, n by 8 nodes that cost 2, and so on until one node that costs log 2 of n minus 1. This sum represents the sum of k times n divided by 2 power k plus 1, where k goes from 0 to log 2 of n minus 1. We take n divided by 4 out of the sum, so now we have n by 4 multiplied by the sum of k times 1 divided by 2 power k minus 1. Take some seconds to grasp this. The terms of this series are all positive, so this series is smaller than this one, where k continues to infinity. And it's fine to work with this one because we're searching for an upper bound. 1 divided by 2 power k minus 1 is 1 power k minus 1 divided by 2 power k minus 1, which we can replace by 1 divided by 2 power k minus 1. Now let's replace 1 divided by 2 by x, and we notice that k times x power k minus 1 is the derivative of x power k we replace. And this series, the sum of x power k where k goes from 0 to infinity, is a known series. Its value is equal to 1 divided by 1 minus x. Now we derive 1 divided by 1 minus x, we get 1 divided by 1 minus x squared. Remember that x is 1 by 2, we replace. 1 minus 1 half is 1 half, and 1 half squared is 1 divided by 4. Now we have n divided by 4 times 1 divided by 1 divided by 4, which is equal to n divided by 4 times 4, which is equal to n. We found out that the cost of heapifying with sift down is n. We get a time complexity of O of n, better than O of n log n that we would get if we used sift up. Okay, now we know what is a binary heap, its main operations, their time complexity, but where would we use it? To answer this question, let's see two applications of binary heaps, heapsort and priority queues. But before, know that here we implemented a min-heap, but implementing a max-heap uses the exact same logic. We just reverse the operators and change some names, you'll find the code below. Let's start with heapsort. Heapsort is a sorting algorithm that uses a heap data structure. It heapifies the array that we want to sort, then it keeps extracting min until the heap becomes empty. That's it. It's like selection sort where we keep searching for the minimum in the unsorted part. But searching for the minimum in selection sort costs O of n, and we do it n times during the process. This is why we get an O of n squared time complexity for selection sort. Which is not the case for heap sort. Remember that extracting min from a heap costs O of log n only, not O of n. This is why we'll get an O of n log n time complexity. Here is an example and what happens when applying heap sort. The time complexity of heap sort is O of n log n, because even if heap define costs O of n as shown earlier, but calling extract min n times costs O of n log n. Because extract min always calls sift down on the root, and the root is far from the bottom. So the first n by 2 extractions may require log to of n minus 1 iterations. We already have the n log n term, it will lead to an O of n log n time complexity for heap sort. The second application is the priority queue. You probably know the queue data structure, a data structure that works on the first in first out principle, where an element enters from the back and goes out from the front. But in a priority queue, elements have a priority related to them, and we want that the element with the highest priority comes always in front. We can implement this structure with a linked list or an array, but one of the best implementations is by using a heap, because of the low time complexity of its main operations. So in reality, our priority queue will just be a heap, either a min heap or a max heap. Main operations of a priority queue are enqueue, dequeue, peak, which returns the element at front, change priority, and is empty, which says if the queue is empty. And because we are using a heap, enqueue is done just by inserting the element in the heap, dequeue is done by extracting max in case of a max heap, peak is done by returning getMax in case of a max heap, change priority is done by using update, and isEmpty is done by just checking if the length is equal to 0. And we finished implementing the priority queue. Note that to have the index and be able to change priority on O of log n, we may need to use another structure to keep track of each element and its index in the heap. Also, note that there may exist a library for priority queue in your language to avoid reinventing the wheel. For example, in Python, there is heap queue. And the priority queue has many applications. We can use it in Dijkstra's algorithm, Huffman coding algorithm, Prim's algorithm, and many other ones. We will see them in future videos, inshallah. We reached the end of this video. In this one, we discovered the heap data structure, its advantages, its implementation, and some of its applications. I hope that you understood all of this. Please subscribe and share this video, and see you in the next one.